Unless you're in the medical field, you might not be familiar with the term iron lung. In fact, we're willing to bet that some of you might hear that phrase and instantly think of that indie horror video game where you play someone trapped in a submarine. But in the medical world, this has a completely different meaning. Now, of course, nobody gets put in an iron lung for no reason. It's not exactly a pleasant experience for patients who require this kind of ventilation treatment. Iron lungs themselves are like large person-sized canisters designed to help someone breathe if their muscle control has been lost. As you might already know, the process of filling the lungs with oxygen and expelling carbon dioxide requires the contraction of several muscles throughout the human body. You don't just need lungs and clear airways to breathe. And unfortunately, some infections out there can prevent the muscles from performing in the way that's needed for a person to successfully breathe. And as you can probably imagine, it's a pretty dangerous state to be in. So that's where an iron lung comes in. Or at least, that's where iron lungs used to come in handy. Nowadays, the large, cumbersome breathing machines have been rendered mostly obsolete as medical technology, especially ventilators, have advanced. However, recently during the 2020 pandemic, some places saw a renewed interest in the device. Iron lungs were thought to be potentially a cheaper alternative to more modern ventilators, especially during the times when there were higher numbers of patients in need of treatment for COVID-19, but fewer ventilators available to meet the demand. But what was it actually like being inside one of these medical contraptions? Just taking a look at the large, cumbersome, coffin-like cabinet doesn't conjure up any ideas that it was a fun time. But to give credit where credit is due, the use of the iron lung saved a lot of lives in the first half of the 20th century. You see, it was during this time that the iron lung was developed as a way to help treat symptoms of another life-threatening infection, polio. Polio is a disease that only occurs naturally within human beings, and it is highly infectious. Catching it would often occur if someone's hygiene was poor or by eating food or drinking water that had been contaminated. Major polio outbreaks began to occur across Europe and the US during the late 19th and early 20th centuries, and sadly, many of those who suffered with it the worst were children. The virus often manifests in symptoms like a sore throat and fever, with some of the more severe cases often including headaches, neck stiffness, and paresthesia, which is an abnormal sensation affecting the skin but with no apparent cause. Perhaps most worryingly though, around 3/4 of all polio cases were asymptomatic, meaning that a person might not be able to tell if they had contracted it until it was too late. Some cases of polio could lead to total paralysis or death, with those lucky enough to survive experiencing continued muscle weakness thanks to post-polio syndrome. So picture yourself during this time just going about your business. Maybe a few days earlier you were exhibiting some mild symptoms, or maybe there were no early warning signs at all. Then you gradually start to feel as if you're out of breath. You try to fill your lungs, maybe slow your breathing down, and take a few gulps of air, but something is making it harder and harder for you to breathe. Your neck might be hurting too, or you might have developed a headache. It gradually gets worse and worse, and you're struggling to function, to move or hold things in your hand, even swallowing or coughing. Then all of a sudden you're struck with the terrifying sensation of being totally breathless. Your lung muscles have been paralyzed, and you're left gasping for air. The one saving grace is that you have a loved one on hand to rush you to the hospital just as your symptoms are starting to go from bad to worse. Then imagine you woke up in an enormous metal cylinder. You'd be sealed up to the neck inside what looks like a coffin on legs. All around you would be the sound of machinery, a noisy whooshing, the whole thing wheezing and sighing. You wouldn't be able to move, to speak, and in some cases you might not even be able to see, thanks to a hood around your head. But at the very least, you'd be able to breathe again. As terrifying of an experience as it might sound, this was the reality for many patients who contracted polio and had to be placed in an iron lung in order to assist their breathing. As incidence of polio rose across Europe and North America, the disease reached a high enough level of infection rate and had spread wide enough for it to be considered an epidemic. At its peak in 1952, there were well over 57,000 cases of polio in the United States within a single year. As well as causing headaches and fever, the paralysis triggered by a polio infection had a severe effect on the chest muscles, which are responsible for aiding and regulating breathing. Without the aid of medical apparatus, a patient couldn't breathe normally and would, in all likelihood, die as a result. Luckily though, Philip Drinker and Louis Shaw, two professors of industrial hygiene at Harvard University, came up with a solution, a respirator that was nicknamed, yep, you guessed it, the iron lung. Mechanical devices to assist with a person's breathing weren't a new idea at the time, but the sheer scale of the polio epidemic forced Drinker and Shaw to come up with a ventilator that could allow patients suffering from airborne illnesses to potentially survive the effects on their lungs by being able to breathe closer to how they normally would. While originally designed to treat coal gas poisoning in the late 1920s, the iron lung would soon become renowned for its use in treating the respiratory failure that could occur as a result of contracting polio. While at Harvard in 1928, Drinker and Shaw developed the first widely used version of the device. It consisted of a huge metal casing with a bellows attached at one end to pump air in and out. The bellows is used to create a blast of air, normally by squeezing a flexible airbag between two rigid boards. Even if you've never heard of such a contraption, you no doubt would have seen one used in older animated movies and TV cartoons, where bellows are often used to stoke a fire, as they commonly were in the real world. Those attached to the iron lung worked with the same principle, expanding and contracting to circulate air throughout the metal chamber. The body of the iron lung itself was airtight, so a person encased within one would have to keep their head outside, their neck supported by a tight rubber seal to ensure the air couldn't escape from within the ventilator. The initial version of the iron lung invented by Drinker and Shaw was often referred to as the Drinker respirator and was powered by an electric motor. This powered the bellows, which would change pressure within the airtight chamber of the iron lung. This would effectively pull air in and out of the lungs of the patient inside, practically doing the breathing for them. Now, at first, the adoption of iron lungs into hospitals was nowhere near as widespread as their usage would later become. After all, Drinker and Shaw could hardly mass-produce enough of their newly designed ventilators to meet the demand created by such a widespread epidemic. So, as a result of this, many hospitals had to first create improvised iron lungs with the materials that were available to them before the large-scale manufacture of the apparatus began. Applying the principle the assisted breathing machine was meant to work on, doctors and hospital engineers had to jury-rig something as close to an iron lung as possible in order to allow their patients to breathe if their lungs failed. One of these custom-built iron lungs wasn't even completely iron. Used in Lansdowne Hospital in Cardiff, Wales, was one that consisted of an iron bed frame with a wooden box affixed to it. To ventilate, there was a set of leather bellows from a metal forge mounted on top of the wood. These had to be cranked by hand. Although homemade, this version of the iron lung operated in much of a similar way as the more technologically advanced successors would, inflating and deflating a patient's lungs by alternating the pressure in the box with the bellows. Luckily, though, after using their improvised version between 1941 and the late 1950s, this Welsh hospital would eventually receive a more up-to-date model of the iron lung. As with any new innovation, especially one that addresses an issue as prevalent as polio, it did not take long for there to be more than one type of iron lung available to the public. The earlier Drinker respirator design set the blueprint for the devices, but was more of a large, angular, boxy contraption, which, while functional, was cumbersome and cost a lot to manufacture, meaning not all hospitals could afford to buy one, let alone the number they would need to treat all their polio patients. So enter a man named John Emerson. In 1931, he designed and improved a version of the iron lung. The key difference? This one was not only far more affordable, but also provided greater access to the patient contained within. Where the Drinker version of the iron lung was constructed primarily of opaque plate metal, Emerson's improvements involved incorporating changes in the original device's design that would make them more convenient for hospital staff to keep an eye on their patients. The Emerson iron lung had portholes on its side, offering a view of the patient's breathing without having to open the machine and risk affecting the air pressure within. Another of Emerson's innovations would make the bed inside the iron lung slide in and out of the metal cabinet, making it easier to place a patient inside for treatment. However, despite the changes that Emerson's design introduced, Drinker insisted that Emerson had copied the design from his original version of the lung, and that this constituted a breach of Drinker and Shaw's patent. They ended up suing John Emerson and took the case to court, where his lawyers argued that the iron lung couldn't be patented. After all, Drinker and Shaw's version had been based on pre-existing technology, and by proving this, Emerson was declared the victor of the lawsuit. The judge presiding over the case also agreed that a technology such as the iron lung being actively used to save lives should be shared and made accessible to as many people as possible. This was only proved even more true when another polio epidemic broke out a few years afterward in Australia. Only 6 years later, in 1937, the number of polio infections in the country were rapidly climbing. But due to the astronomical cost of not only purchasing Drinker respirators, but transporting them all the way around the world to Australia, a more easily accessible alternative was required out of necessity. And so the Booth respirator was created. Much like the Emerson version before it, this new iron lung improved on the weight and cost issues of the Drinker invention, created by a biomedical engineer named Edward Booth, after the South Australian Health Department asked him to come up with a cheaper alternative. However, unlike both its predecessors, this iron lung was built using plywood. This not only made the manufacture of them incredibly cheap compared to other metal versions, but also much lighter, so they could be transported far easier. Some of the Both respirators even saw their first use only a few hours after they were constructed, rushed out to hospitals to begin treating polio patients. A British philanthropist and car manufacturer named William Morris was so impressed with Both's iron lung that he personally financed the production of the new model, overseeing the creation of around 1,700 of the machines at his motor manufacturing factory in the UK. Morris, who was also a lord, then donated the Both iron lungs to various hospitals around the world. Well, those within the British Empire, at least. Much like the Drinker respirator and the Emerson iron lung that preceded it, Both's version of the machine applied the principle of negative pressure ventilation, artificially pushing air into a patient's lungs to aid in the respiration. The attached bellows would extract air from the main chamber of the iron lung while the patient was sealed inside and the container kept airtight. Then, as the internal air pressure began to lower, their lungs would expand, drawing fresh air into their diaphragm. The machine's bellows then reintroduced air into the iron lung, creating a rise in air pressure, which would push the air out of the patient's lungs and cause them to deflate. This created a rhythmic sound as the air circulated within the iron lung, which provided doctors with reassurance that the patient was once again breathing. But what was it actually like to be inside an iron lung from the patient's perspective? We've explained the science of how an iron lung functioned and even some of the history behind its development, and why it saw the rise in usage thanks to the polio epidemic. But for those who found themselves needing to be placed inside an iron lung, the experience could be bewildering, unfamiliar, and even downright frightening for some, especially for the number of young children who were unfortunate enough to contract polio. And that was just what the experience of receiving treatment could be like. And if that wasn't enough, the point at which many patients were placed within these cumbersome ventilators was usually when their polio was causing them intense pain and even delirium, thanks to their inability to breathe, causing a lack of oxygen to the brain. This was the reality for one such patient, a man named Paul Alexander. In 1952, at the age of only 6, Paul contracted polio, and the virus would ultimately leave him paralyzed for the rest of his life. During the polio epidemic, most businesses had been shut down, particularly those that encouraged large groups of people to inhabit the same space, whether sealed indoors or staying outside but remaining close together. If you have any vivid memories from the initial COVID-19 lockdowns, then you probably remember a lot of similar mandates happening at the time too. This meant no movie theaters, bowling alleys, bars, or even public swimming pools permitted to stay open. Yet it did little to stop the rising number of polio cases as the summer of 1952 rolled on. In July of that year, a young Paul Alexander was playing outside when he began to exhibit his earliest symptoms, pain in his neck and a severe headache. Upon seeing his condition, his mother sent him to rest up in bed, where Paul would spend the next few days. His fever climbed and he experienced aches and pains in his arms and legs, yet his parents were advised by a family doctor not to take Paul to the hospital. It was clear to the doctor that the boy had contracted polio, but with the sheer number of patients already suffering from the virus, the local hospital was too overcrowded to properly treat the young boy. Although the doctor claimed that Paul had a better chance of recovering by staying home, over the following days his condition only worsened, to the point where he struggled to speak or even cough. He was rushed to the hospital, where the staff took him to the dedicated polio ward, but given the high number of patients, they were overwhelmed and unable to treat Paul immediately, and sadly he wasn't the only sick child who was suffering. When a doctor was eventually able to see Paul, there seemed to be nothing that could be done for him, and he was left on a gurney, barely breathing. Had another doctor not decided to examine Paul a second time, then he most likely would have died. But luckily, this doctor performed an emergency tracheotomy, suctioning the congestion out of his lungs. Then Paul Alexander was placed in an iron lung. Already, this had to have been a harrowing experience for the poor child, and waking up to find himself inside a strange machine could not have provided much in the way of comfort, even if he was thankfully still alive. Awaking in an iron lung, Paul was unable to move or speak, and was no doubt terrified to find himself encased in a big, wheezing machine. The iron lung he had been placed inside had a steam tent and a vinyl hood that surrounded Paul's head. This was designed to keep his head moist and keep the mucus in his lungs caused by the polio loose. However, his mechanically assisted breathing had fogged up the window. With no idea what was going on, a young Paul thought the worst. Fortunately, despite his fears, he had not died. When the hood was removed, Paul was able to see again. He noticed he was in a room surrounded by other children, all with their heads sticking out of iron lungs. There were rows upon rows of fellow polio patients all encased in metal canisters, while nurses wandered between them. Being inside an iron lung was difficult both for the patient and the medical staff charged with their care. Having one's entire body from the neck down, trapped within a breathing machine, meant none of the patients could use their hands, and many were so weakened by their polio symptoms it made movement next to impossible. As a result, doctors and nurses had to work around the clock to provide blood transfusions, intravenous glucose feeds, inserting and replacing patients' catheters, and endlessly checking that the iron lungs were working as intended. The help provided to patients wasn't just limited to strictly medical procedures either. Itches needed to be scratched, noses needed blowing, and everyone needed to be thoroughly washed without exiting the iron lung. So these tasks fell to the nurses, most performed through the portholes in the sides of each lung, provided the hospital had Emerson or both versions of the device. In some instances, the patients were able to exit their iron lungs to undergo physical therapy, but they only had a few minutes' worth of breath outside the metal ventilator. For Paul, the 18 months that followed his awakening inside of the iron lung were far from easy to get through. Thanks to the emergency tracheotomy he received, he couldn't speak, although he could hear the frightened cries of other children experiencing the painful symptoms of polio. As he soon learned, life on the inside of an iron lung was incredibly boring, especially for a child who would rather be outside and active. Many iron lungs were fitted with mirrors so the young patients could easily see what was going on around them, and Paul would often use this to communicate with his fellow patients by making faces at them. Those who were lucky could have books suspended in front of their faces, but someone needed to be around to turn the pages. Unfortunately, the survival rate for polio, even among patients who were being treated within iron lungs, was not perfect. Many still died, including those on Paul's ward. He remembered that every time he made a friend with another patient, they seemed to pass not long after. As for Paul himself, he made a recovery from his initial polio infection, however he was left paralyzed from the neck down. The regular change of air pressure inflating and deflating his lungs within the ventilator was literally keeping him alive. If ever the staff had to open his iron lung, poor Paul was forced to hold his breath until they restarted the machine. Although he would live for many more years, Paul needed the support of an iron lung for the rest of his life. As an older man, he described a vivid memory of overhearing doctors talking about his condition. Often, as they did their rounds, they would remark that they didn't believe the young boy should still be alive, or that any day he would succumb to his polio. As Paul recalls, it angered him, but it kept him determined to survive the ordeal within the iron lung. Over time, he was gradually able to leave his iron lung for extended periods of time, and Paul would go on to live to this day, at the ripe old age of 77. He also holds a Guinness World Record for being the person who spent the longest amount of time living in an iron lung, as well as being the only person alive today to live inside an iron lung, as Paul still needs to be placed inside to aid his breathing. While not typical of all polio patients or even all of those who were treated via the use of an iron lung, Paul Alexander's story does provide us with one of the best, most detailed descriptions of what it was like to live inside an iron lung. Now watch, what does it actually feel like to be shot? Or check out this video instead.